I'll call the meeting to order. It is 7 o'clock. Happy New Year to everybody in the room and on Zoom, and this is our first Select Board meeting of the new year. So we have two sets of minutes to take a look at tonight. We're missing one of our Select Board members tonight, but we do have a quorum. And so we're looking at the minutes of December 13th, 2022. Is there a motion to approve?
I'll move to approve pending modification.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Page one. And page two.
It's a very minor change, but under, it's item three, Parks or Recreation and Parks, Allenbrook should be two words.
Oh, yes, it is. Hearing nothing else on the corrections on December 13th. All those in favor of approving the minutes of December 13th, 2022, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Three ayes have it. And we're on to the minutes of December 20th, 2022. Is there a motion to approve?
I'll move to approve pending modification.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Page one. Page two. And page three.
Just one minor thing under 13. The second bullet down, last sentence, reads, capital items include replacement of the person door frames and doors.
I read that too.
And I assume that's opposed to garage doors, the big overhead doors.
Yeah, that's what actually what they said, so yeah.
Just wonder if maybe we should just add that clarification.
Probably a good idea.
I mean, it could be the dog doors, the cat doors.
Well, personally, probably.
The Selectboard doors.
Yeah. Anything else on page three? If not, all those in favor of approving the minutes of December 20th, 2022, say aye.
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 So we're done with the minutes, and we're moving on to public comment. Anyone in the room who has any public comment? Seeing nobody here, anybody on Zoom that has public comment?
Not seeing anyone for public commentary.
Okay. And we'll move on then to interviews and appointments. We do have one interview to conduct tonight. That's for the Conservation Commission. David Westman, why don't you come up to the table, and we do have your application in front of us. And if you give us a brief description of your background and
sure.
why you'd like to be on the Conservation
Commission. Yeah, thank you very much for having me. I'm excited for this opportunity. Many years ago, I was a community organizer for the Sierra Club, and I worked on public lands preservation and wilderness in California and Alaska and Utah, and so conservation is very much deep in my passion and my bones. I left the Sierra Club and the conservation community to focus my work on energy, and since graduating from Columbia in 2006, I've really been working in the utility and public utility regulated space. My current job is Director of Regulatory and State Agency Affairs.
Recording in progress.
For Efficiency Vermont. And I was just joking with Eric that I want to do this for my community because it has virtually nothing to do with my day job, but very much speaks to my passion for getting outside, protecting lands, trails, parks, outdoor recreation, especially for the residents here in Williston, and being able to make those lands accessible and available for everyone to enjoy. I'm an avid hiker, outdoorsman. I take my kids hiking even when they don't want to. I take my dog hiking even, well, she always wants to, so she's always game for that. So that's where I sort of sit, and I just wanna be a part of this community and do something for my community. That's why I'm here.
Good. Thank you very much. This is the time that the board gets a chance to ask you a question.
Age where if we left them alone for an hour or two, you know, either they'll keep themselves busy with library books or the Switch, one of those two things.
Other questions?
Hi. Hi, thank you for applying. Have you had a chance to look at the town plan and how it addresses conservation?
Yes, I have been a part of several of the town plan organizing events. I led the subcommittee that developed the town map. I worked very closely with Matt and his team in the planning office and led a small group of volunteer citizens to put that map together. It was right on the eve of COVID, and we were working on that plan through the fall of 2019 through 2020, and then I followed its progression as the town plan developed, and it got overshadowed by the massive sort of like zoning and planning discussion that was going on for the Taft's Corners area and the sort of development zone, which is fine. That's a really big deal. But for my part and the part of our little subcommittee, we were really focused on trying to explore alternative transportation methods and identifying future multi-use lanes for the town and how people could access not just that development zone, but also thinking longer term about like where in the future the rural parts of the town we could look for conservation easements, we could be on the lookout for paths and primitive trails and bike trails. We came up with a lot of really sort of unique ideas that were sort of presented as, you know, connecting some of the further out bike trails to the Richmond trails, which would then connect to the multi-use trails, which would then bring us into the downtown, and, you know, trying to sort of bring that web together. So yes, I'm familiar with it. I very much had a strong part in at least one aspect of it and have been following it for several years.
Okay, great. So how are we doing? Asking that question a little bit differently, if you were to be on the Conservation Commission, what would you advocate for?
I think Williston has a really unique funding mechanism for identifying and protecting lands. For a town of this size to be active with foresight, to have a dedicated resource like the, forgot the exact word, but you know, the conservation budget, to put money aside to protect lands that are important for the town and for the residents. I think that's really the strongest asset that the Conservation Committee would be able to make recommendations to the Select Board for, obviously. But I think generally we also have, and I participated in this, we went to the Conservation Committee for recommendations on, you know, when we were doing that town map, and we got input from that committee about primitive trails and places where we would like to see expansive trail networks connected. And I got exposed to a lot of things that had been long thought of from that committee, and we ultimately put them in the plan. So I think there's a lot of sort of roles to play in the future of planning, but I also like the opportunity of, as I was just kind of getting ready over my lunch hour for this interview, I was going through some of the old minute meetings and, you know, just little things like, if you acquire a parcel of land, how are people going to access it? You know, and I just went totally into a rabbit hole and I started pulling up plots of land that the town owns and imagining like if I wanted to get to that property, how would I do it? Where would I park my car? Would I be able to bring my dog across private property? Like, is that a legitimate or accessible piece of public land if you can't actually get to it? Those are the kinds of issues that I think the Conservation Committee should also be addressing too, is that, you know, if we're gonna make the investment, if we're gonna spend those resources, we also need to think about how are we gonna guarantee access. It's a big issue also with, like the Nature Conservancy. This was something I dealt with out west, was when the Nature Conservancy bought a parcel of land, but then didn't build a parking lot or even just signs to announce that it's open and accessible, they called it the Nature Conspiracy because it was basically not an accessible piece of public land. It was just sort of being purchased and then put aside. So that would be one of my passion areas, is making sure that it's accessible.
Okay, good, thank you. Hopefully this, well, actually, it won't be my last question, because there is a question I get to ask at the end.
Go ahead, I'm having fun. This is great.
So we have the Environmental Reserve Fund, you know, with the purpose of buying, either buying land or conserving land.
Right.
How are we doing with it? Asking that question maybe a little bit differently would be, how much land is it appropriate for the town to have in conservation? Are we halfway there, quarter of the way there? Are we too far?
That's a great question that I would love to dig into as part of that committee. I mean, I will say that the preservation of the Catamount Forest, which used those environmental funds, it was a tremendous opportunity. It was a great gift for Jim to make that land available, and to then for the town to sort of follow through on that was huge and progressive and a great asset for the town in perpetuity. So more opportunities like that, I think, is what we would want to preserve. But I mean, obviously there has to be a balance, and I think that's where the development zone and the residential zone and the rural zone, all of those things need to sort of be balanced, you know, and that I think pathways through the residential zone that lead to the downtown zone that, you know, also make the rural zones accessible are the types of things that I would at least be looking for as opportunities moving forward. Venues, including this one a couple months ago, like, that is my focus, and that's my passion, is trying to get as far as I can possibly get without getting in my car.
Okay. And I'll ask, this question gets asked of pretty much every candidate for a town committee. I, for some reason, get to ask it.
Okay.
And it's a conflict of interest question.
Okay.
You alluded to, you don't see a conflict between your work and this job.
Right.
But if there were a conflict, how would you recognize it? What would you do?
The easiest answer is recusal, right? Any public servant who sees a conflict of interest has an obligation to recuse themselves from the proceeding. I've been in many DRB meetings as a member of the public and have witnessed that. So there's many opportunities for a council person to step aside and say, this is too close to home, or I have a vested interest in the outcome of this, so I'm going to recuse myself. And I think the obvious answers to something like that would be as if a piece of land were in discussion that were abutted my property, right? Like, that's the most common or clear example. I don't get involved in energy placement, you know, so it's like my line of work is totally within the already built environment. And so I wouldn't see any conflicts there with like renewable energy or anything like that. My current role would not sort of put me in any kind of conflict there either. Okay.
Good, thank you.
Any other questions? If not, there is a motion suggested.
I'll move to appoint David Westman to the Conservation Commission for an unexpired 4-year term through June 30th, 2026.
Is there a second?
No second.
Is there any discussion on the motion?
No. Thank you.
Thank you for this opportunity.
All those in favor of the motion say aye.
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 Aye. So congratulations and welcome to the commission.
Thank you. Look forward to it.
Thank you.
Have a good night.
Very much.
So next on our agenda is the Winooski Valley Park District annual update. And I believe we have both of our presenters on Zoom this evening. Nick Warner, who's the executive director, and Reed Willis, who is our appointed representative from the town.
Yep, I'm connected right now, Terry.
Okay.
Nick, you'll just need to enable your camera and audio, it looks like.
Okay.
Oh,
so it's actually operations manager Lauren Jacoby. Nick should be joining soon. Yeah, we share the same Zoom, so I think he should be on as well.
Yep. I see him now, Lauren.
Okay. Sorry, that happens all the time with us sharing.
There were two Nick Warners, so
yes.
So I guessed. There's Reed.
All
Let's see, Nick Warner, I see you connected. You'll just need to enable your audio and video. There we go.
There we go. Okay, so Lauren has a PowerPoint. Is there any chance you could enable her to put that up for us?
Yep, I think it should be all set.
Okay, great. And I'll keep it brief.
Thank you.
It's not an extensive PowerPoint. I know when you hear the word PowerPoint, sometimes it... and I just want to thank you once again for making the time to let us come in and present to you. And my name's Nick Warner, and I'm in my eighth year here at the Park District. Lauren's been with the Park District for a couple years longer, and our park superintendent, who was our third full-time employee, how many years? 25 years? He's been around a long time. Yeah. I'm very grateful to both Tim and Lauren for sticking around. They provide a lot of continuity and skill to the system. I'm just going to do a brief overview. Some of this will be stuff you know already, but for those who want a quick primer. So the Park District is a really interesting hybrid nonprofit and intermunicipal corporation. This is our 50th year. We're going to figure out how to celebrate that in the spring when we can all gather outdoors. We have incrementally grown over time. We have 19 properties, a little under 1,800 acres. You can keep going. And this is more detailed than you need to read right now, but basically, we've had seven towns for a lot of years. I got to say, we're thrilled that Essex Junction voted us in. So we now have eight member towns. We don't have a trustee yet, but Regina is going to be recruiting someone to join our board. We're thrilled about that. I just want to thank both Essex Town and Essex Junction for really just giving us a lot of help in the transition. We're thrilled to have them on board. It's very, in terms of how we operate, like I say, we have a small, very efficient staff, and we're highly reliant on leveraging and volunteer and outside resources to accomplish our goals. Go ahead, Lauren. Thanks. We've had a long history with the town of Williston. You guys have been extremely faithful and consistent in your support of our operations. We've made a commitment to work with the town to acquire property within your borders. I connected with the folks from the Baptist Church, and through no fault of anyone, I think they've tabled for now their intention to go to the next level on their housing project. And how that relates to a park in Williston will come up in a couple future slides here. I was at your board last April to talk about the Jacob Parcel project. Want to go to the next? We're just going to fire right through these. We have a part of our mission is education that gets carried out in a bunch of ways. Lauren has done quite a bit in this area. We focus on being an excellent host, and we work with students at every level, from pre-K all the way through graduate students, on a variety of projects and initiatives and service learning opportunities. Next slide. We are highly dependent, and it's baked into our model, utilizing volunteers. We have a lot of folks and organizations that year on year keep coming back and assist us. Williston Rotary has been very helpful to us, and other groups from various corporations. REI has been helpful to us. And it's part of our operating model. We don't depend on them to do our regular maintenance. We have a seasonal crew that does that for us, but in terms of doing invasive removal and special projects, tree plantings and so forth, we use volunteers quite a bit. Next slide. Another thing that we instituted, I think we're in our fifth year doing this, maybe our sixth year. In fact, Williston was the first, no, excuse me, South Burlington was the first time we worked with on this. We decided to do contracting for our member towns, which means that we work on parks that are not owned by the park district, but are owned by our member municipalities. And it's worked out really well. It's a win-win in that we charge a very simple rate, which is the base rate plus 50% for our staff. And we don't mark up materials, and the insurance is typically wired in because we all have the same insurer with the Vermont League of Cities and Towns. And it means that we are able to generate revenue to help offset the town's financial obligations to us writ large, and also are able to use Tim's incredible expertise to help put together projects for the various towns. And we've done quite a bit with Williston this year. We were cutting a lot of trees, doing a lot of trail work, repairing puncheon, and we look forward to doing additional work with you guys in the future. Leveraging is really the game with us. This is just a quick summary of where we're at in terms of our grants in hand, and we're hoping that this grows. I'm probably putting together a large grant for a repair of the barn on our Ethan Allen homestead property. We also have a great tenant with Forest Preschool that provides us income, and the Ethan Allen Homestead Museum, and contracted maintenance, as I had mentioned. We also are a fiscal agent. We do that on a fee basis, unless it's a very small grant. We have a couple instances where we have not charged a fee, but since we have an established bookkeeping system, we provide that service for small nonprofits as they are working through their issues. Next slide. Okay, that's the quick and dirty. I wanted to present an overview for those who are less familiar with us. As you can see from our annual report, we're really very focused on capital projects right now. We've got, we own, as I said, 19 parks. Within those parks, we have 7 historic buildings, and we're pretty focused on getting some funding to do upgrades in Ethan Allen Homestead Barn and the actual Allen House. We are also, over the last few years, we've been prepping to do major upgrades at Colchester Pond. We actually added some parkland there. We added a new access off of East Road. And there is a historic farmhouse there that we had analysis done 4 or 5 years ago to get an idea of what we need to do to upgrade that building. We also have a VORIC grant which is seed money for upgrading our wetlands walk, which is an incredibly heavily used resource that we had to shut down a couple years ago because after 30 years, it needed replacement. So that's a big project. So we are very laser focused on upgrading our assets and also on incrementally growing the system over time. I mentioned the Jacob parcel earlier, which is, I think it's been delayed. I need to talk with the church and find out what their situation is. But there's a couple other properties near the Winooski River mouth that we're looking for a potential acquisition to expand the Durway Island and Durway Cove parks. So that's my quick overview. I wanted to leave time in the 15 minutes allocated for you folks to ask questions about. You probably have questions about your allocation in our budget. So I'd like to open it up for questions.
Yeah, thanks, Nick. Yeah, this is a budget night, so you did present the in your overview that we received a week or so ago a new request for funds. So if you want to just talk a little bit about the price tag and what we'll be getting for it.
Yes, I mean the challenge in these times. With inflation rates above 7% right now, and the Social Security COLA is going to be 8.7 this year. We have this healthy tug of war in our trustee meetings where we try to come in with as low a budget as we can that is responsible. This year we're able to pull that off with a 5.5 4% overall increase in our budget, and a similar increase depending on which town you are in the requested town allocations. It is, I still feel like overall people are getting a pretty great bargain in terms of the amount of land and free public access and ecological health that we're protecting for what's being asked. For those who are not familiar with our system, we use it's called the fair share analysis each year, where we look at the equalized grand list and the population of each town. And you have a document that shows you last year and this year's allocations and how they were arrived at and the math that we used to get there. And it's our system that we use to determine basically the affordability factor that each town can realize each year. So Williston's equalized property values jumped a bit more than other towns. So you're coming in at 6.3% higher than last year, which is still beneath the inflation rate. So I actually feel pretty good about that. That was a consideration. Interestingly, having an additional town doesn't help us at all in terms of saving money. It's not like they bring in new money. They just become part of the mix and essentially the two Essex entities are now split, but the relative amount of resources they bring to the table are still the same in the big picture. So we're pretty happy with what we came up with this year for the budget. We provide a pretty detailed budget overview, the budget notes that are provided you. This is a really important document to us, as we feel it answers the questions up front that you might have about the various costs that we realize. And we try to keep the budget simple and clear and easy to follow. So if there's any, are there any questions about our budget or the allocation this year?
Good, thank you. So any yes. questions from the board?
Jeff. Hey, Nick. Not really. Good job. As I went through the budget, it appears, when I look at all the different line items and sort of run through them, it appears to me that we're really looking at a cost of living increases throughout those numerous line items. Would that be accurate from your standpoint?
That would be accurate, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. No new programs, that type of thing.
No, just an expanding responsibility for upgrades and maintenance. Okay. But you're absolutely right that the main driver of the increase in the budget is personnel and the cost of living. Like I said, we have a small staff, we have an experienced staff, and I can say that, you know, both Lauren and Tim could find employment elsewhere for more money. They're not doing it to get rich, but we do compensate them. We generally target the middle. So the compensation is based on comparison with other similar organizations, and we do an annual review of that compensation to make sure we're paying people fairly. Okay. So that's you're correct. That is the main driver for increased cost is the cost of personnel. But everything costs more now. So
I guess my only other question is on the next page of the overview we received, which is the fair share analysis.
Yes.
And in the math is there.
Yep.
Is that approach going to stay there? It's I know it's been there for many years, and we've raised some questions about it in the past. I'm not uncomfortable with it. I just would like to know what you and the board think of that approach.
I would defer to Reed a little bit on this. We really, since Reed has been around, she hasn't been part of that discussion as much. We did a deep dive on that back, 4 or 5 years ago. And it's difficult to create a system that is progressive enough to represent absolute fairness. The question sometimes comes up, you know, why does this town have more parkland than we do? If we start using the acreage as a factor, the whole system starts to break down in terms of, we did a lot of analysis of this 4 or 5 years ago. Frankly, in the last couple of years, we've been so busy taking care of the increased usership of our park system, which has continued, I'm thrilled to say. Pretty much the first day of when the governor declared the lockdown, people just filled up our parking lots, and it hasn't dropped off that much, especially in the larger parks. So it's a long way of saying that we have not taken another serious look at that. We're always, I'm a believer in that things change over time, but I also, as I look at other systems that are similar to ours, our system is very efficient and very progressive relative to a lot of other systems. We're pretty happy at the staff level, pretty happy with the system. If the towns would like us to take another look at it, you know, we'd be happy to do it. But it's about as progressive as we can come up with. And it has been in place. It was in place when I got here, and I spent a lot of time researching different models. Interesting, a lot of the districts that I researched where county government is stronger, they place like a very small percentage in the county tax rate, and that's how these systems are funded. And there's a complete disconnect between the funding source and the actual system. What I like about this is getting grilled by the towns each year because it keeps us honest. I mean, I think it's a good system. I think you asking that question, you should ask that every year. How did you come up with these numbers? Because it directly connects us with the towns that we work with. I can tell you that relative to the amount of acreage that we manage and the amount of access that we provide, you know, back of the envelope, I'm running a $700,000 organization for $400,000. So, you know, I remind myself of that when we have to scrape to get stuff. But it works because we are partnering with all these different conservation groups and nonprofits that help us leverage funding and services and labor and ability to function.
Good, thank you. My only other question has to do with the Jacob parcel. You brought it up.
Yes.
And you made the comment that you need to get in touch with the church. So you expect progress on that in this upcoming?
Well, things were moving forward quite well. They were on the October agenda to get themselves to the next level. I've been communicating with Brian, their engineer, and with the folks at the church. And we were all awaiting. I was actually had in my calendar to get in touch with them now after the first of the year so we could start working on the easement language. And I found out that they have paused the project. I don't know what that means, but I will find out. I think emphasizing that they were very clear, it has nothing to do with the town process. But given, I can guess that given, you know, interest rates and cost of materials and labor supply, you know, they may just be taking a deep breath and waiting for the economy to rebound like a lot of people are doing right now. That's a total guess. I need to reach out in cooperation. So I don't have answers on why they're pausing or whether they're altering the project or it's just a timing issue. So I wish I had that information. I don't have it right now.
Okay. Do I read into that the project might be in jeopardy?
Well, you know, we started this project before the housing project was proposed, and they were willing, I can't speak for them, and let me start with that, but they were willing to consider the parking lot and easement even before the housing project began. And then when they started putting that project together, they realized that there was an inherent benefit from a permitting and public service standpoint, to embed the trail easement and the parking lot in the project itself, which is how they have it designed currently. So I don't know what they've never said no. The housing project is not a condition of working with us. I just, in fairness to Randy and the great folks at the church, I need to reach out and say, okay, what do we do next? And you know, the good news is once you get across that border, there's an existing right of way that goes all the way to the edge of the property. And there's other ways to access that parcel. So I need to reach out to Randy and find out what their next steps are.
Okay. Then my last question actually is for Reed, and that question is what do I need to know?
Is she still there?
Oh, Reed, you're muted right now.
I feel like I'm still in a learning curve. However, I can say I've been extraordinarily impressed with how much the district does with so little, so to speak. I think the idea of leveraging what they have, both in terms of the funds and the expertise, is an understatement. What do you need to know as a select board member? I think the Jacobs property is going to be the most exciting thing, and I feel like we're just on the brink of something really tangible starting to happen. So I'm hoping that that's going to be the most exciting thing upcoming.
All right, good. Thank you.
Anything else, Jeff?
No. Nope.
So thank you both for being here, actually all three of you for being here tonight and giving the updates, and we'll move on to our next item on the agenda. So thanks again.
Thank you for your time. I really appreciate it.
Right. Thank you.
So moving on to a favorite topic that we have at this time of year, the sidewalk plowing requests. And we have Eric will lead off and Bruce will join in on the requests.
Thanks, Sarah. I prepared a memo for the board in your agenda packet this evening that walks through the overview. As Terry mentioned, this is part of the annual review for the board. The town sidewalk maintenance policy calls for requests for new sections for winter maintenance, specifically plowing. Review during the budget season in preparation for the following year's budget. Requests are submitted in guidance criteria within the policies reviewed by the Public Works Department. I'll mention the lead off, as discussed in prior years, the Public Works Department is at capacity to provide sidewalk plowing with a single plow in our fleet. Currently, the town plows about 15 and a half miles of sidewalk and multi-use paths located primarily adjacent to our primary, to our major routes and travel in town. Our sidewalk plow maintains about 10 miles, and a pickup truck plows the remaining about 5 miles of path sections. Takes a member of our public works staff about 4 hours to plow the sidewalk section after a 3 to 5 inch winter storm event. And a number member of our staff operates the pickup truck to plow the 5 miles of multi-use path. That takes about 4 hours as well. And 4 hours is our standard time for winter operations for staff to complete a route, whether that's plowing roads, sidewalks, or paths. So with our network overall, we have around 30 miles of town-owned sidewalks and paths in Williston. And in addition of a second plow, would also require a staff member. We would need that to operate the equipment. And if there's a mechanical issue, as a reminder, with a single plow, we don't currently have a backup. I'll let Bruce speak to this in a couple minutes, but the recommendation from Public Works, based on the criteria, is going to be add the sections requested to the town's winter operations plan, with that caveat of needing additional equipment and staff to go with that equipment to do so. If the town were to add a second plow and staff, the entirety of the sidewalk network could be added. So it's about 10 more miles that aren't currently being plowed, with the capacity to add some more sidewalks as built in the coming years. The addition of the Blair Park sidewalk that we should speak to is 0.4 miles long. And our other requests, the new path on Route 2A from Hurricane Lane to the State Police Barracks, that's about 1/3 mile. And making that change could occur in the current winter operation season, should the select board wish to make that operational change right away. So In the current draft budget, additional sidewalk plow and staffing configuration are not initially included. Draft budget did not add new services due to the economic climate in this initial draft. Looking at pricing, a second sidewalk plow likely costs around $150,000 for the piece of equipment. As we discuss this further, if the select board wants to consider addition of equipment and staff as part of your FY24 budget deliberations, staff can certainly prepare cost scenarios and budget impacts for you as you work through the budget the next couple of weeks. So with that setting the stage here, I'll turn over to Bruce to walk through the specific requests for the board.
So we have two requests, I think, by Bruce.
Yeah, two requests. One is a repeat from last year, which is the Blair Park sidewalk. As you know or don't know, we've completed the sidewalks all through Blair Park now, so you can do the whole loop. Even last year when the request was made, the recommendation from Public Works was that we add it, but that if we added it, we're looking at the equipment and the manpower that Eric just alluded to. And the other new one right now is the new section of, the new section of path that has been built from basically the Vermont State Police building on 2A South to Hurricane Lane. Neither one of those are being done right now. And there's also other sections, newer sections, I mean, that haven't been talked about, haven't been requested, and the commercial buildings are doing in themselves, and that's the section from Zephyr Road going toward Taft Corners to where 99 is. There's all that new path along there that we're not plowing. That was added actually about a year or so ago, but it does appear to me that the commercial businesses are doing that themselves anyway. But it is, you know, path that was put in. That's part of our system at this point.
So the new sidewalk that's on 2A between the State Police Barracks and Hurricane, that goes along Route 2A. Any possibility the state might be able to do?
The state won't plow sidewalks.
They don't at all.
No, they won't. Anytime you want to put a sidewalk in the state right away, it's going to be the town's responsibility if you want it. That's the only way they're even going to allow it to be built. So even up to the park and ride, if you remember, they came and said, you know, because we made a requirement as building part of the sidewalk up through there too. Well, we'll build it, but you need to maintain it. So they just don't do it. If they're not in the sidewalk plowing business. They don't want to be in the road plowing business either. Neither do we, so, but not really. So the new section from the state police, on Route 2A up to Hurricane Lane, we could probably, since it's done with a pickup truck, we could probably do that starting now, actually. Just because that does have a little bit more, it has a little bit more room than the sidewalk machine. The thing that we have to remember is that a pickup truck gets on a road and drives. So it gets to a destination to do its work, where a sidewalk machine may be able to drive on the road as well, but it's not going very fast anyway. So that's one of the reasons why it's harder to say, okay, it's only a little bit more sidewalk, we can add it, but it's the distance. And in Blair Park, we're already there, I grant you that. But there, it's actually quite a bit more sidewalk to do to go around that loop. So.
Questions?
So with existing capacity, so you feel like you could, without hiring anybody additional or anything, could take on the 2A piece right now? Okay.
And the worst thing that would happen, Greta, is it would be later. Yeah. But we could certainly.
But later's better than not at all.
Yeah. And the only good news about a pickup truck is actually the paths are easier because we have two trucks that could do that. Mm-hmm. Whereas with the sidewalk machine, we got one sidewalk machine, and when we lose it or it goes down, mm-hmm. Right. We're not going to be doing any sidewalks. And at the beginning of this season, I asked our new highway supervisor to call around or look around and see if something did happen to our machine. what would be the availability of being able to rent or get something? And it's just not, it's not there. So, you know, having been around long enough, trying to even ask another town to borrow a machine or whatever, I haven't done it since I've been in Williston, but we have tried to do that in the past other places, and they're all busy doing their stuff too. So we really, I guess what I'm saying is we really need a second machine. I mean, we really do, because if one breaks down, at least with that second one, we could make some effort to get things done. It's going to take a long time, but it's not going to bring the whole operation to a stop. And there are a lot of places now where people are walking in Williston.
And what's the lead time? And I know we've asked this before, but what's the lead time on ordering one and getting one?
Oh, we probably won't get one before next winter.
Just right. Okay.
Even if we put it in the budget,
yeah,
we're going to be lucky. I haven't tried to order one, but with everything else we're ordering, we're seeing a year out. So it's probably beginning of next winter.
And so you're advocating, even though we might not have the personnel to operate a second one, like simultaneous to this one, having a second one at this point would still be beneficial because this current one is on its last legs. And
well, the current one is due to be replaced in 2025.
Right.
The last time we bought this machine was $120,000 in 2015. Mm-hmm. So $150,000 is not an unrealistic number at this point. So would it be good to have one? Sure. But it would be even better to have the second one with the person.
Right. Yeah.
And quite honestly, it's a lot easier on me and Public Works to just do all the sidewalks. Mm-hmm. I mean, it really is. Let's just do them and be done with this. We're not going to do this section or that section or whatever. There's not too many other municipalities that do it the way we do it. I mean, what we're doing is wrong, but most other places, if you have sidewalk, they're getting plowed. The only other one I know that does it the way we do it is the town of Essex. Mm-hmm. And they may have even changed since the last time I checked with them.
And we're, looking at, the form-based code and a lot of the initiatives and things we're doing, it does seem in line with a lot of our other efforts to want to have a much more walkable town, to have actual walkable sidewalks in the winter. So.
Well, we'll talk about that during the budget,
yes.
I guess. Bruce, the question I have is, it sounds like what I'm hearing you recommend is Blair Park is in, and the, no.
2A is in.
2A is in. Blair Park, the extended part of Blair Park is not in, or we shouldn't approve that. Okay. Are you recommending that we add that segment of the path from the state police up to Harvest Lane?
To Hurricane Lane.
To Hurricane, what did I say?
I'm sorry, I don't know what you, but to Hurricane Lane.
Yes, yeah.
I'm saying that we could do that. I mean, our policy is set up that anything we decide to do now gets started next season.
Yeah.
But what I'm saying is I feel comfortable enough that we could add that short section that's plowed with the pickup truck.
Okay.
And start doing it the next time it snows and we plow, which we don't even go out and do until 2 inches of snow anyway.
Yep. Okay.
But, and once again, if that pickup were to break down or whatever, we do have another pickup or truck, small, that we could put on that and still have that done. It's the sidewalk machine that we're in trouble with.
Okay.
And the sidewalk machine does have a, when we put one of the implements on it, one of the operators says it tries to creep forward on them while they're doing this implement. We sent it to New Hampshire and had some things adjusted, got it back, seemed to be fixed, but then seemed to start doing that same thing again. $14,000 fix, has to go back to New Hampshire, and it was right at the beginning of the plow season. And I made the decision I'm not going to send it back down there right now. We won't use that piece of, until springtime again anyway, but that doesn't mean that something can't happen to that machine now because of that. So this machine seems to be operating fine. The last big snowstorm, they plowed twice with it. The operator has no problem with it. The machine seems to be doing fine in just a snow plow mode. We'll see if we have to go to blower, whether that makes a decision, a change or not.
So part of the budget process is to also hire a person to operate the equipment, but that's a limited time frame that that would occur. So what would the person be doing the rest of the year?
We would probably use this person in what we're trying to establish is a building, a more permanent buildings and grounds type crew. Right now I have a person and a half that takes care of the buildings. And when summer comes around, I lose actually the full-time person, goes back to, goes helps out in parks. And then we're dependent on if we can hire a part-time person. And it's getting harder and harder to do. It's getting harder and harder to find the full-time positions. After Friday, I'm down three people. So, anybody want a job? But anyway, we'll make do, but so, and obviously, Terry, but I'm sure my highway supervisor would sit here and tell you, you give him a person, he'll find work for him anyway,
yeah.
So.
Yeah, I'm sure. Okay. Any other questions for Bruce? So this will be a topic of discussion as we go into budget deliberations tonight and next week. So thank you.
Great, thank you all.
So we've got about 7 minutes before the public hearing. Perhaps we can start then on the public works facility solar panel purchase option that we talked about at our last meeting and see if there's any further feedback that folks have on that before we actually make a decision on that. So Eric, you want to start off with that?
Yep, and Linda Scott will be joining us as well. She'll be on Zoom here in just a moment. So as Terry mentioned, we previewed this for the board your last meeting at the end of December. The town has a purchase option for the solar panels located on the roof of the public works facility. This option can be exercised in the fall of now this year, 2023, with adequate notice provided, which would need to be by the end of June. I think it's 120 days notice or so. Since the facility was constructed, the town has leased the solar panels on the roof of it and received 10% of the net metering credits generated. Our option agreement states the purchase price is $125,000, and that's fixed for the solar panels. Looking at a possible way to purchase these, the town has $132,500 in unspent bond proceeds when the town sold bonds in 2013 to build the facility. I consulted further with our town attorney on this, and should the select board wish to use the unspent bond proceeds for the purchase, it would require the approval of the voters to do so at town meeting. Looking at the timeline to exercise the option, town meeting in this March is the potential window for that, asking that question, should that be a direction the board wants to move in. The remaining $7,500 unspent proceeds could be used towards additional capital purchase, or towards the debt repayment for the 2013 bond sale. And we continue to pay down those bonds. I think there's another eight years or so until they mature as a 20-year bond. Our staff suggestion is looking at using that towards the debt service. Also look at something, if it was purchasing equipment, say a sidewalk plow. $7,500 is something, but it's a smaller number in the grand scheme of the price tag there. So it's something to think about. But if you were to decide to use it any other way, that'd have to be part of the question on the warning coming up in March, if you want to go that direction. So the questions for the board to make a decision on, the first is, does the board wish to exercise the purchase option on the solar panels this year once funding has been identified? And if so, would the board want to ask the voters at town meeting day to consider using the unspent bond proceeds for the purchase? Board doesn't need to make a decision tonight, but certainly probably want to consider something by your next meeting, just in the fact the town attorney's helped me drop some initial, we need to adopt a necessity resolution for the bond dollars on the warning. Town attorney's drafted that, giving them a little more as much time as possible is helpful for them right now, as a number of municipal clients are asking them to work on bond documents and legal items for town meetings. So Melinda's here as well. If you have additional questions, Melinda and our consultant Jeff Forward provided the presentation at your last meeting on the dollars and cents side of this as well.
So is there any questions that you folks have tonight, or is there more information that we need between now and next week?
I don't have any specific questions. I think Jeff and Melinda did a great job of presenting the numbers and all of that last week and or a couple weeks ago, and you know, fully support this becoming a town-owned asset. I think, again, it speaks to our town goals and our energy goals and so forth. My question more relates to that $7,500 specifically. If we do, we would need to designate the intended purpose of that, so it couldn't just be like, we'll be like to also spend it. We're not sure what we would need to.
Yeah, if it's going to be on another piece of equipment, my understanding is you probably would need to designate that in the question. If it's going to be used to just pay off the debt, I'm not positive that we would need to identify that in the question. It's probably most efficient to try to figure this out right now, as opposed to having a $7,500 potential question in the future. We do need to spend these and likely figure out a pathway here in the short term. If it's not for this project, then another project.
And the attorney feels like we could use it for, say, a sidewalk plow?
Yep, you could decide to ask the voters to reappropriate the proceeds for another piece of equipment.
Is it because it goes towards public works?
Or in general, we had a question when we purchased the solar trackers behind the town hall about 4 or 5 years ago, and we used a combination of some of these proceeds as well, plus some fund balance towards that effort. So it's, I bring you some money that you need to spend. So
I'm trying to figure out the bond issue, not issue. We took out a bond to build the public work facilities. I assume it was for X million dollars. And we now have a remaining amount left in that bond that has not been spent to build the public work facilities of about $132,000. So is that first concept correct?
Right.
I wanna make sure I got
that. So that project, as I understand, came in under budget when it was built. And
believe it or not, yes.
When we went to bond sale, you know, it's the Vermont Bond Bank pools this debt together and you sell a municipal bond. So the amount was sold at that time, and the town's paying off its portion of the bond sale.
Okay. What other uses could that $132,000 be used for? I mean, I guess that's part of what I want to understand.
Yep.
For instance, is it appropriate to use it to pay down the debt on that bond versus, you know, buying, in a sense, something new?
Yep.
Different.
That's an option for the board. You know, by state statute, you can use unspent proceeds to purchase equipment or pay down existing debt.
So the equipment could include the solar panels?
Correct.
Or the solar system, or could include a sidewalk plow. I guess does there have to be a nexus with public works?
No, there doesn't.
Okay. All right. It couldn't be used. It couldn't go like into the general fund to be used for, to pay down, lower taxes. Probably not.
No.
Yeah. Okay.
You know, this is recalling what the town attorney told me. Those are the two uses in state statute for for a board to look at when there's unspent proceeds from a bond sale.
Okay. And how much longer do we have on our needing to pay down, or what's the word? Pay off our bond.
Pay off the bond. See, it's a 20-year bond. I think it's 2033 or 34. Surely it's in our debt schedule here too.
I'm sorry, I was just looking at like the draft necessity resolution that Bob put together, and it is specific to the funds must be used for other eligible capital improvements.
Okay.
Or paying down debt.
Okay.
So use that. So I'm just looking at the answer to that question. So Bob, I'll probably give you
I think it's another 9 or 10 years or so.
I mean, in a sense, it feels like
2033.
You know, money that's available. I just want to make sure if that's sort of how we should think about it. I want to feel comfortable with how we're going to spend it. And surely the question I would have for you, if you don't mind, in addition, is if we were to use that 132 to pay down the bond debt, would that have a significant impact on, you know, either the time remaining or the amount that needs to be repaid?
It would not have to pull, my computer isn't cooperating right now very well. So we cannot decrease the term of the debt.
Oh, interesting.
So the term is the term that, you know, so we have 10 years left. We have 10 years left. So it could pay it down in increments and pay off the interest. Well, if we can use it for principal, we can't actually even use it for interest. We can only use it towards principal. So we might have to use it for multiple years principal payment.
Okay.
I think Eric's point is that maybe to explain the answer to your question a little bit more, Jeff, back when these bonds were floated, the debt, whatever the principal was of the debt, was our debt, and that's what we're paying down. But the funds used to come to the town directly to invest. That no longer happens. When we issue debt, it goes with a trustee, and then we submit for reimbursement, and the trustee holds those funds now. This just happens to be from years ago when they used to give us the bond proceeds directly. We wouldn't see this happen anymore, the fact that we're actually holding these funds.
Okay. I guess the bottom line question then becomes, or not becomes, is from a sort of, I don't know from what standpoint, I want to say financial standpoint, but of course it's financial, it's money. Is it better to use that $132,000 for a one-time purchase, like a snowplow or like a solar system, versus using it to pay down your bond?
I'm going to say yes, because we build the debt service into the budget, and it stays at a level amount other than the interest is what continues to go down as the debt gets older because the principal is going down. So that leaves us, you know, a very common flat budget versus these large capital expenses might make that budget spike. And we could help take the spike out of the budget if we're funding it with these dollars that we already have and need to spend.
To give the board, you know, our debt service in FY24 on these bonds was $4.8 million. Our principal payment's $240,000, and our interest is $105,000. The interest goes down every year as the principal's paid off more.
Okay.
And I remember from Jeff's numbers, I don't have them pulled up in front of me, but there was a pretty significant, bump in our solar credits that we would get. And so, you know, owning versus renting them as we do now. And so, that asset would be working for us financially.
The big thing is the potential roof replacement at some point for the for the facility, where I know in his analysis felt as though there's couldn't do worse than breaking even. And financially, as we receive those credits, it reduces our electricity spend on our accounts throughout the town.
So we'll be discussing this next week. And if you have further questions, if you'd send them off to Eric quickly this week, that would be helpful.
Okay.
So it is just a little past 8, and we're on to the public hearing. And notice is hereby given that the Williston Select Board will hold a public hearing on Tuesday, January 3rd, 2023 at 8 p.m. in the Beckett McGuire Meeting Room at Williston Town Hall to receive comments on the proposed operating budget for fiscal year 2024 and capital budget and program for fiscal years 2024 to 2029. And with that, I'll open the public hearing and ask Eric to give a quick overview of what we are looking at tonight, and then the floor will be open to public discussion.
Yep, thanks, Terry. So I've just have an abbreviated presentation from what I transmitted to the board in early December, just to set the baseline for the budget proposal for folks who are here and watching us at home as well. So looking at some general themes in preparing this budget this year, no surprise, we've mentioned already this evening, is inflation and the effect on those factors. The cost to provide the same level of municipal services is increasing due to economic factors beyond our local control. We're seeing a 30-year high in the rate of inflation. The Northeast Consumer Price Index, our local index that we look at, through last October, the 12-month average was 7%. I believe it went down slightly in November, and the December numbers aren't out just yet. Nationally, through that October timeframe, it was 7.7%. We're also looking at employee recruitment and retention, maintaining a competitive compensation structure in a very challenging job market right now. We have open staff positions over the last year, and we have some additionally right now. We're producing very limited number of applicants to look at. It's a very challenging job market out there. And delivery of services is centered on our staffing, and I say many times we have an excellent town staff. We're very fortunate to have the staff members we have, and we'll look to retain that staff and attract new members to our team moving forward here. And we also keep in mind our planned community growth. The board has in its transmittal, the planning department tries to take a estimate through the best we can with our information available what the growth may be. We estimate that about a little over 2% conservatively the next 5 years. So think about that and impact on services. And I shared this graph just from the New York Times, just showing the inflation and then the spikes from where we are, about a 30-year high in inflation right now. So when we prepare the draft budget at the staff level for the select board to work through, we have to make some assumptions and identify some policy levers each year. So some of the key assumptions and levers we've identified this year, looking at our cost of living and merit increase, we've budgeted generally 3.5% cost of living increase for staff in the budget. That's the ceiling identified in our active union contract. It's not for renewal right now. I think as mentioned earlier, this means the actual rate is much higher. And we've also included 2% for either a merit pay or a step increases for unionized staff. So that equates to generally a 5.5% increase in wages for staff. And also on the slide too, just looking at our benefits as well. We did change our health insurance carrier. We looked at a $180,000 health insurance increase, and we were able to decrease that to about $120,000 by changing carriers and offering a comparable plan, but that's still a significant 8% increase just in health insurance alone for the next budget year. We also look at our grand list growth. Town assessors sort of estimates about a quarter of 1% for next year. This affects the overall tax levy projection. Grand list is finalized in the spring by the listers. So that quarter of 1% is about $5 million in new property value he's projecting. And dollars-wise, that with the current tax rate, that yields about $15,000 in new revenue from that. We anticipate a reappraisal is going to occur probably from 24 to 25, and we'll have some more information on that this evening as well. We've shifted our local option tax revenue to our pre-pandemic methodology. We use a rolling average of 3 fiscal years. We're continuing to omit the first half of 2020, as those were outliers, especially on the rooms and meals side. And then the budget also looks at the town's unassigned fund balance and ARPA funds. These are offsets on the revenue side to consider to assist in balancing the budget with a phased step-down use. And that's been outlined in the draft budget. So my direction to staff in working through to submit budget requests last fall was look at a status quo budget. Proposals with costs to provide the current levels of services based on the pressures faced with inflation. Any new or expanded services were submitted as a separate request. And then in the town manager's draft budget, there are a limited number of expanded services, primarily some additional staff hours. There's no new personnel in the budget proposal. Our goal was to deliver a budget expense increase lower than the rate of inflation. We did that with a 6.5% bottom line increase in the draft budget to consider which is lower than the national and northeast numbers we looked at the time. So as we look at it by object, I think it's a good way it kind of tells a story. The primary source of the increase is related to wages and benefits. And then we see the operating side, items like contracted services, insurances, vehicle fuel. These are all related to delivering operational services, and those are numbers driven by our inflation pressures that we're feeling right now. So general fund by the numbers, as I mentioned, the bottom line, 6.5% increase, about $850,000 in the draft budget. Initial rate looking at taxes, about a 3.25 cent increase. What does that mean for a median assessed homeowner, about $300,000 home? I mean, would mean about $98 increase per year, or about eight over the year, or $8 tax increase per month. Then generally the revenue side of the budget, similar to prior years, our property tax levy makes up about half of our general fund operating revenue, local option tax about a quarter, and everything else about a quarter, a little bit lower this year. Then our capital budget proposal is about $92,000 increase from the general fund that gets transferred in. There's no new debt proposed. We worked throughout it to consider future planning with the town's energy goals in mind. And our debt service is about 7% of the general fund overall, which is a good place to be. So the next steps, public hearings are just about to occur. The board has next item on its agenda to begin your budget deliberations. Next week at the budget meeting to continue your budget deliberations. Could potentially look on the 17th to finalize the budget and the town meeting warning. There's also time on January 4th to hold an additional meeting to wrap items up if necessary. Then we have town meeting on the 6th and Australian ballot on the 7th of March coming right up. So pause there, Terry.
Thank you, Eric. So for those in the room, if you would come to the table when you wish to speak, and those of you on Zoom, also identify yourself when you come to speak, and if you can, be very specific about what you like, not just the tax rate's too high, but where would you like us to do to change it. So I'll open the floor up to folks in the room who wishes to speak first. Eric, your assistant coming with you?
All right. Thank you, everyone. I am Eric Howe. I am the chair of the Williston Conservation Commission, and I am here to speak about the budget. And I understand that the this year's budget does not include any allocation for the Environmental Reserve Fund. Before I get into that, Jeff, as I was walking into the room tonight, I heard you ask our now newest Conservation Commission member how much land you thought, or he thought, would be an appropriate amount of land to conserve in town. And I have to be honest, I didn't actually hear his answer, so I don't know what he said to you. I was more thinking about your question. The Conservation Commission's perspective would be, the answer to your question would be 30%. Of the land in town. And that is based on a number of factors, but I think partially driven by President Biden's executive order from earlier in his presidency, directing or requesting that 30% of the lands across the country be conserved for a whole host of different reasons. And then that number was recently backed up in a large gathering of biologists, conservation biologists in Montreal a month or so ago, maybe 2 months ago now. And so the Conservation Commission took a very quick look at this and supported that idea. So we have today, and that executive order to conserve 30% of the nation's lands by, and as also by the year 2030. So it's the 30 by 30 initiative. That's very strongly supported by land trusts and conservation organizations across the country. The tool that we have is the Environmental Reserve Fund and the conservation easements. And that is by far the strongest tool in our toolbox here in town to protect lands for conservation. The other tools include zoning and bylaws, but they can all be changed, right? A lot easier than changing the trust or whatever the vehicle is used to conserve a parcel of land. A good example is your conversation at your last meeting that you had over around the Glazer parcel and the specific plan for that process. Where was I? So 30% of the land area in Williston would equate to about 6,000 acres. Right now we have a little over maybe 2,200, a little over 2,000 acres. I think it's 2,200 acres or so conserved or protected, which gets us to about 15% or so of the land, 12 to 15% of the land in Williston. So we're doing really well. The ERF was first put in place in 1989. The town was directing $100,000 or so, give or take, but pretty close to that each year in 1989 and throughout the early 90s. And then since then, the contribution to the ERF has fluctuated from as much as a couple of hundred thousand dollars in that very specific case to conserve the Catamount parcel, down to zero in a few budget cycles. I don't actually know off the top of my head what the average, if we were to average it out, what that would be. Probably somewhere in the order of $50,000 or so per year. I think it was in 2014, maybe 16, 6 or 7 years ago, the Conservation Commission did a bit of an analysis and determined that a good, healthy balance to maintain in the ERF would be in the order of $400,000. That's where we're at now. However, as you all know, and Eric just discussed, property values have increased quite a bit over the past couple of years, and that recommendation of $400,000 balance is very outdated. And that puts the town at a disadvantage to be able to work quickly to conserve parcels that may come up as an opportunity to protect. We went through a prioritization exercise in 2020, working with the Vermont Fish and Wildlife Department and their conservation design program, and ranked all of the unprotected parcels in town using several different conservation criteria. And the top 20 parcels that came up or that were identified added up to, just by sheer coincidence, 2,500 acres, which would actually get us to, if they were all conserved, would actually get us to 30% of the land conserved in town. At that point, and that was $2020, I think, maybe slightly earlier, the total value of those 20 parcels was about $9.2 million or so. Retta, you mentioned earlier tonight the form-based code effort in Taft's Corners, and that reminded me as well so the plan for that area in town has been to become the urban center of the town, and that predates obviously the form-based code effort by a long shot. But the idea there is to encourage growth and development in that part of town, concentrate development. But it doesn't protect the rural areas of town from suburban development. And we, you know, as I just mentioned, we have our strong bylaws in place now, but they can be changed. And working to concentrate development in Taft's Corners, but not protecting the rural areas from development, kind of defeats the purpose. One without the other doesn't the whole plan, which is a great plan, just doesn't work. So the Conservation Commission is recommending three things to the Select Board this year, and that is first to designate $100,000 in the FY 2024 budget to boost the balance of the ERF to reflect the increasing property values we're seeing here in town. The second is to establish a policy to reach and maintain a working ERF balance of $800,000 and include this policy in the 2024 town plan, which would then enable the town to either work on conserving two high priority parcels simultaneously or back to back on the town. If we conserve one parcel at $500,000, then we wouldn't have to work so hard to get the ERF quite or back up to a target value. And then the third is to establish a plan to fund the ERF at $100,000 annually until the target balance is achieved. Lastly, Eric kindly did some math for me and informed me that a $100,000 increase in the budget or allocation to the ERF would equate to a roughly a 0.7% increase in the proposed budget. And that is a direct investment in the future of Williston. Some could view it as an additional increase, but it's, you know, I think the Conservation Commission would support me in saying that it should be a part of the town's budget, not in addition to the town's budget. Thank you.
Thank you, Eric. And we'll be discussing this, I think, at least a little bit tonight and perhaps in next week as well.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Anyone else in the room who wishes to speak tonight? Yes.
Sorry, it's Reed.
I'm Reed Carr. I'm the vice chair with the Conservation Commission, but I actually wanted to speak tonight just as my perspective as a resident here in Williston. And I also wanted to speak about the Environmental Reserve Fund and its role in the budget and its role in the town. When I've been listening to public hearings recently, when I've been reading from Porch Forum and the comments that are submitted on all the different things that are happening in town, I do hear a lot of voices that feel like development is out of control. And I don't necessarily agree with that viewpoint, but I do think it should cause us to pause and think about why that gut reaction is happening. And I think as I've sat and watched these hearings and read through all of the comments that were submitted, what stuck out to me is that it seems as though residents of the town feel like there's a very well-defined and well-functioning pathway to develop in Williston, which I personally actually think is a good thing. You want a process that is consistent. You want a process that is clearly defined, easy to follow. We want the same thing for conservation in town. And we do have some things in place, including the ERF, but I don't think it is as clearly defined. I don't think it's as clearly communicated to the community, and I don't think it's as effectively executed as our process for developing land in town. And so I think what ends up happening is that there gets to be this feeling that it's out of control, that there's so much urgency from those who want to develop properties, and there's this void or vacuum as far as the progress toward conserving the valuable open spaces in town. And so I think that one of the things that we could do, the reason that I was in support of the recommendations from the Conservation Commission, is that I think setting a policy to establish a good, robust fund level, and also show year over year that we are working financially as a town to achieve it, would go a long way for folks who are feeling like things are just a little bit out of control. And so for that reason, I just wanted to encourage you as a resident in town to think about the ways in which we can address the underlying things that might be driving some of the outcry that we've heard in recent hearings. Thank you.
Thank you. So people on Zoom, are there folks who wish to make public comment?
Not seeing any at the moment, Terry.
Not at the moment. Yes, sir.
Kevin Thorley, Vice Chair of the Energy Committee, though speaking for myself as a resident here. And all the talking points I had, I think Reed just exciting. But so I want to just throw my support behind what Reed said. Specifically, you know, we had such a, I think, awesome open process for the TAF Corners form-based code, but we heard a lot of feedback about growth and, you know, unabated growth. And there's, if you're on Front Porch Forum, like Reed mentioned, you've seen a lot of comments related to the Glazer property. This seems like a really great opportunity for Williston to kind of put its money where its mouth is with regard to, you know, preserving the character of the town. And I don't know which way it will fall when we look at, do we want open space and town character, or do we want low taxes? That's a decision everyone needs to make for themselves. But I think this is a good opportunity for us to take some of the feedback that we've heard from so many people on both sides of the form-based code discussion, and really, you know, give the town the tools that it can use so that when these discussions come up in the future, when properties become available, you know, we can make a decision other than just develop it. From a personal perspective, I drive by Jeff's house 3, 4, 5 days a week in the summer to go up to Catamount. I think the open space that we have in this town is a huge asset to the town. And the way that we've preserved it, the way that we operate it, and, you know, give the townsfolk the opportunity to use that space. I know that's why, one reason I live in Vermont, I know a lot of folks that would probably say the same thing, hiking, walking on trails, biking, cross-country skiing. I think it's a great opportunity, and the ERF, you know, will allow us to continue to have more opportunities like that. Thank you.
Thank you. If there is nobody left on Zoom.
I've got a hand on Zoom. So.
Pardon me?
I've got a commenter on Zoom.
Oh, okay.
So I, Terry Marin, I'm going to connect you right now.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yep,
hi, Terry.
Great, oh, wonderful. So yes, so the last three speakers covered everything pretty well, but I am a member of the Conservation Commission. My name is Terry Marin. And I've been on the Conservation Commission for a couple of years now. And the Conservation Commission really worked very hard in 2020 and 2021 with Melinda Scott, the former conservation planner, and Jens Hilke of the Vermont Fish and Wildlife Department. And we worked really hard to identify significant wildlife habitat areas and prioritize certain parcels that were of high importance. And without having the proper tools to do this work, and one being the ERF, it puts us at a huge disadvantage. And the town needs a sufficient balance in the fund to purchase land and or the development rights. And the residents, in the past have spoken out time and time again about the pressures of development here in Williston and how it's changing the town's character. And in 2019, just before, you know, the pandemic hit, I was part of a kind of a loose-knit group. We called ourselves the CRG 2.0. And I know some people get a chuckle out of that. They know what that was. And it was all around, we all gathered together because around the glacier parcel that folks thought was going to get developed with, you know, many houses. And out of that, the town put together a survey and put that out for folks to respond to. And there were 70 pages, not 70 comments, but 70 pages of comments. And most of them were not in favor of the pace of development that was happening in town and what was going on. And now again in 2022, 23, the town residents are vocalizing again about the amount of development happening in Williston and all the things that come along with that. And it, you know, the glacier parcel is one of the properties that's, you know, kind of under the survey. You know, people are seeing this happening again, and I just think the town needs to properly provide, you know, fund the ERF in order for the Conservation Commission to properly function and fulfill its duties to the town as a committee. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else on Zoom?
No one else on Zoom, Terry.
Anyone else in the room who wishes to speak?
Terry, I forgot to say one thing.
Yeah, why don't you go up to the mic.
Yep.
I just wanted to add one thing. This is Reed Carr again. I wanted to add one thing, which is that it was mentioned that we don't control when these properties become available, and we have to be able to act. And it was really enjoyable at the last Conservation Commission to have somebody up on Old Creamery Road come and speak with the commission about trying to develop a pathway for their family's land toward conservation. And it was very disappointing at that conversation to be able to only be able to say, you know, right now there's nothing we can do. We can't even do anything in terms of the Glazer parcel, we don't believe. and we don't have the funds to work on more than one at once. And her response was, well, what can we do? You know, how can we make it better, that the opportunity is better? And one of the main things that we could say is if you can work with other landowners in your area so that there's potential better matching of funds, which is one of the huge ways that ERF has been used to match funds from something like the Vermont Land Trust, so that we can preserve a larger area all at once. So there are conversations ongoing in the background, and people are coming forward to the Conservation Commission looking for that pathway to do it. So not just the Glazer parcel, but also a couple landowners up between Old Creamery and Sucker Brook Country Park right now. Thank you.
Good, thanks. If there's no one else who wishes to speak tonight, then a motion to close the public hearing would be in order.
I'll move to close the public hearing on the FY24 budget proposal.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Is there any discussion on the motion?
Just checking, Eric. Nobody?
Nope.
Okay.
Nobody else.
All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Aye. 3-0. So, okay. So now we're into budget deliberations, and Eric, perhaps you can just give us a little overview of what you expect us to give to you. Obviously, we'll be talking about some things tonight that either to add things to the budget or subtract, and what would you expect from us?
Yep. So I prepared a draft budget direction to come in, taking a conservative approach here. There's certainly, it's always a challenge in putting the budget together with, there's certainly a lot of great opportunities for the town and you as a board trying to balance, your spending side of the budget, your revenue side of the budget, and trying to look at a number of these factors. And this is the largest public policy endeavor you have each year, so it's certainly not an easy job. As I support you in my role as manager, I'm looking for where you want to end up in your budget proposal, looking at the bottom line on the expense side and how you're going to fund that on the revenue side. If you're looking at additions, subtractions, direction you want to give me and Shirley as finance director to run cost scenarios for you, we can prepare that information for you as you decide as a board where you want to end up here. You've got time next week to work through this as well. You can work through it with a couple more meetings this month, but by 17th to the 24th, we'll need to arrive at the bottom line as part of the town meeting warning. So what we do every year is come up with possible budget changes. So this is in your agenda packet. There's just a couple items so far. We do our best estimates, but sometimes things come up after the turn of the year here. So see, there's about $5,600 in additions, and those result from Greenmount Transit had a slightly higher request than what they initially submitted to us, a little bit higher for town meeting TV, and the Chittenden County tax was slightly higher than what we anticipated it may be. So to date, that's $5,600 from those outside organizations to meet their appropriation request that came in. Look for the board's direction and how staff can support you in working through this.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, when I was in the legislature, the Appropriations Committee would look at $5,600 and call it budget dust. And so, I think we're probably all on the same page as far as putting some money into the Environmental Reserve Fund. And I'm looking at what other departments in town were told to do, and that is to follow the status quo. And so we have the opportunity to do that, but in order to follow the status quo, that would be $75,000 rather than $100,000, which I think is probably more appropriate for this year, since we are looking at a fairly steep tax increase. So I would ask staff to take a look at what $75,000 would do as far as increasing the expenses of the on the budget.
I know Eric had mentioned just, and that you had prepared the numbers for him for the fully funded $100,000. ask to, but if you could also just, we could just see the difference, like what that would mean for the budget. I would also, I'm a, obviously, I don't know if I made it clear, but a big proponent of getting that sidewalk plow. So, and I actually, you know, in talking, you know, obviously we have still a finite amount of ARPA dollars, and but in our last meeting we had discussed, you know, that we are coming up to some barriers in terms of timing of using that money and ordering things and getting it and having it actually spent. And so, and you know, we had discussed a lot about, you know, doing things for the town that really would benefit the town. And so for me, that really does fit the bill. So I would support, you know, potentially using ARPA funds, but I would love to see maybe some numbers about, you know, using the ARPA funds and maybe not using ARPA funds, how that might affect things. For us to get the plow at the minimum, but also to add an employee, since we know that that's necessary too.
But would the employee be added in the following fiscal year? Not.
Well, because they would have to be available to use the plow, right, for next winter?
Hopefully you'll have a new plow in town, right. So that would be about half of the fiscal year.
Yeah, so.
Yeah, we could run a scenario where they would start, say, December 1st, for example.
Yeah.
That'd
be great.
See what the impact would be in the cascading year too, as you have a full year with that employee. One thing we've looked at too is potentially looking at, we have a seasonal parks position. We may be able to run some scenarios looking at elevating that to a full year. And I can speak more with Public Works and Recreation and Parks as well to look at different staffing models too.
Okay. That'd be great. Thank you.
So what I'm hearing, seeing, feeling is three significant budget increases that we should be considering. We've talked about the ERF. We talked about the plow and the new staff that would need to come with the plow. We haven't yet talked about the solar panels on the Public Works, the solar system on the Public Works garage. All three of those, I think, are very consistent with, you know, the town's goals as expressed in the town plan. So I'm in favor of all three of those. But I also think before we can move ahead in deciding whether we want to pursue any one of those or all three of them is, are we willing to make cuts in other places? And that's a discussion I think we need to have. You know what else to add to that?
If you took all three of those things and put them into a new budget, what would it take? And this would be up to staff to take a look at. What would this be? Where could we cut that total amount of money?
Right. If we were to stick with this, I think the budget's coming in 6.6% higher than last year. Excuse me if I got that wrong.
Yeah, 6.5. About that.
If we wanted to maintain that 6.6%, what would that mean? And fund those, you know, three things.
Well, the solar panels wouldn't take any additional funding, right?
I'm just trying to see if I can pull up a spreadsheet.
Yeah.
So the solar credits right now, because, you know, they're owned by ISON, we get 10% of the credits back, so really we'd be generating additional credit against our bill.
Right.
So I'll just write that as a note. We'll look at that mm-hmm. to factor that in. If we purchase, that would reduce our electric cost a little bit.
Right. I get it. They all three don't have an equal impact.
Right.
You know, one-to-one impact.
Well, but the funding for the solar panels is not a wouldn't be a budget item, right? Because we have.
Right.
That comes from existing, right?
Right. If the board wanted to use the unspent bond proceeds for that purchase, if you wanted to look at general fund dollars or ARPA or, you know, another potential use for ARPA, those are other buckets you could look at. But you know, the most significant impacts are if you were to look at raising additional taxes or using additional fund balance, for example, to pay for things and kind of where you want to land on those aspects as well.
So if we were to pursue that, we would not have to include it in the capital budget and then, you know, state where it is we would.
Right. If from following. If we look to purchase the solar panels with the unspent bond proceeds, think of that as a completely separate pool of money. It's been in a separate fund in town. It's not going to affect the other aspects of the capital operating budget.
Okay. I mean, I get the concept. I'm just trying to figure it out from the standpoint of what have we done historically with the other solar panel systems. I forget if it's one or two that we've already purchased. And is that consistent with our capital budget, whatever policy? In other words, you know, it is a sizable expense. You know, it's one time and it's over the 10,000. I think there's a rule of thumb we use, 10 or 15,000, it's above that. So even though we have this special pot of money we can use to fund it, does it still need to be part of the capital budget?
I see what you're saying, yeah. We likely would include it as a sheet, just as a capital planning asset. Okay. But in terms of the funding mechanism, that would be the coming from the bond proceeds.
A way to put it is if we fund it as part of the capital budget, and let's say through this, I forget what it's called, where you use the bond, the amount we overbonded and we have available to us, it may have negligible impact on the tax rate, on the need for revenue, but it still should be part of the budget.
Right, to reflect the asset.
And, I'm getting a better understanding now.
For me, that's the easy part, just generating a new capital sheet and just make sure that's reflective in your plan.
And if anything, Shirley's saying we may see a little...
So you could reappropriate those dollars towards an operating expense like an employee. Yeah.
It wouldn't offset the additional sidewalk plow expense or whatnot, or employee expense, but it would... Help.
One thing I do want to say about the plow and the additional staff is, I remember this came up last year, was the first year where I kind of said, you know, the way we every year go through via our policy and rank people who apply to have their sidewalk plowed, to me is, sorry, I'm going to be a little dramatic, it's kind of nuts. and we should, if we wanted a sidewalk to be there, whether we built it or the developer built it, we ought to plow it.
Mm-hmm.
And get away from this, you have to apply and then we become the sidewalk plow gods and decide whether you're good enough,
right,
you know, for lack of better words, for us to plow you or not. And I'm being a little bit dramatic, I get that, but I would feel so much more comfortable if we said, no, these are the areas of towns, or these are the sidewalks that we plow and pass that we plow, period.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you don't have to apply. You're either,
right.
I don't like saying anybody's out, but there might be a case where some sidewalks just, no, the town is not gonna plow those.
Well, we've gone to great effort as a town to have connectivity between sidewalks and between pathways and between things and, you know, and it doesn't really matter if all of these things connect if, you know, X neighborhood isn't going to be plowed, so you can't get to the places, you know, this plowed area here from this plowed area here.
I greatly prefer that the whole town, all sidewalks and paths get plowed, and if we can achieve that, that would be good.
You know where the money comes from.
Well, that's, of course.
Just so I have clear, so you're talking about kind of these three items and with different potential pools of money. If you'd like me to look at potential, what it would mean to decrease expenses as budgeted right now and replace them with some of these, which ones would you like me to do?
So you can give us the real bad news, and then we have to make a decision on that.
That's our job.
Sure. We'll run those numbers. You know, it's likely with that amount of spending, you'd be looking at personnel, and also looking at tied to increases in personnel wages as well to get that. Just a preview for you for that, and also capital funding for other items in the capital budget to get to that multiple hundred thousands of dollars level for a trade-off.
Mm-hmm. Again, and I would definitely encourage, I mean, it just from my perspective, at least the plow item could could be a use of ARPA funds, so I'd love to see what that would look like at least.
That and the budget, the fund that we have for that we're always looking at spending and quite often don't, so.
Mm-hmm. I have some concerns about how we're spending.
Yeah.
And that isn't a negative comment. Right. I just want to make, I want to feel comfortable with how we're using our, this great resource we got, these ARPA dollars. If we use, when we buy a sidewalk plow, mm-hmm. we are all going to be buying sidewalk plows for the rest of our lives. that's a commitment we're making. So while the ARPA funds pay for it the first time, mm-hmm. it make it easier the first time we have to buy that second sidewalk plow. Yep. In the future, what do they have, an 8-year, 10-year life? Mm-hmm. We got to be buying a new one. I have the same feeling about when we hire staff. Yes, it's great if we can hire staff and bring them in halfway through a fiscal year, let's say. That's a great idea. But the next year, you got to have that commitment that you're going to fund that position. And so I'm not there yet on using ARPA funds for the sidewalk plow.
Well, and if you look at that, we do the same thing we do for dump trucks. We would be putting aside a certain amount of money each year right. to replace that sidewalk plow.
Yep, right.
I think we're good on this tonight, and we'll see some news next week. Yeah.
That's what I anticipated you'd ask me to work on.
They were taking
might bets. Already be working on it.
Yeah. Taking bets. They're taking bets. Long, by the way.
So let's move on to the donation gifting naming policy. And Eric and Shirley, I think if you have any comments on this, Shirley, might you come up to the table as well?
If this was presented to the board last meeting, end of December. There's just been a couple changes. Shirley gave it a review. So there's a few red line changes that Shirley suggested, primarily relating to IRS requirements. If there's any questions on those, I'll defer them to Shirley.
Oh, do you want me to make comments? Oh, sorry. I thought if you just had questions. So taking my previous experience into account working with St. Michael's and working with institutional advancement for my 20 years there, the language that I wanted to add in, just removing the land donations to gifts of real property, that's just about the fact that real property includes land. We could get something, a land in a residential or commercial building on it. And those things just add complication that we really need to stop and talk about and review and what types of liabilities might surround those particular gifts. So I just wanted to add that language in so that, we stop and pause and ask all the relevant questions and, is there hazardous materials that might have to be mitigated, et cetera. And then the last section, really, I just added was about the IRS requirements for acknowledging a gift at the bottom of this document. And that is pretty much it.
Any questions for Shirley on this?
Seems pretty standard language.
If we're okay with it, then there is a motion suggested.
I'll move to adopt the parks donation and naming policy.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Is there any discussion on the motion? Hearing none, all those in favor of approving the motion, adopting the motion, say aye.
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 And then we're off to the draft town meeting day warning.
So usually prepare those for the board, first meeting in January here. This is the first draft. So I'll start with starting to think about how you want to conduct town meeting this year. We've reserved the auditorium that was available that night, so that's the good news to start with. Like, there's no bad news, but that's good news. So I've presented the warning here back to, we'll call it the pre-pandemic, so March 2020, when we had town meeting before things really changed throughout the world for a couple of years. So you don't have to decide this evening, but to be thinking about how you want to structure town meeting. Do you want to have you know, the in-person meeting in the auditorium again, have some floor articles that we've had in the past, moderator, due date of taxes, accept the town report, followed by a presentation about the Australian ballot articles, including the budget. And then we've been in touch with the school, and they certainly welcome an opportunity to go through the school budget that evening as well as part of that program. So that's one decision point for the board. And my thought there, you know, with a hybrid environment, we're traditionally have live streamed that. It may be a little challenging to try to facilitate a Zoom engagement as well. And the board really, well, if the board wants to go in that direction, I can certainly explore it. But just for you to think about too, just looking for your direction on how you want that to be set up. Just some of these logistics to think about as you get your warning together this month.
Does it have to be, I mean, can it be live streamed without having the ability to engage back?
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, we can.
Yeah.
Hope that Kevin, well, we can do that, right, Kevin? That's what we usually do, right? That's right.
Okay. Yeah. So, because I think, you know, while that does inhibit, you know, participation, obviously, in the process, and I think that the hybrid format has been phenomenal in terms of getting people, additional people who may not have otherwise participated, to participate. I do think having it at the school and having some return to kind of the pre-pandemic town meeting format is great. And if people still have the option to at least view it, you know, in that format, that's good.
Absolutely, I think we need to have an in-person town meeting just to get people back together in the town. It's been a couple of years of pandemonium and pandemic. So to get people back together, I wish we could do a hybrid meeting, but get into a problem with voting at that point. The only way you could vote realistically then is by a voice vote, which is okay, but if somebody demands a written ballot, we're in trouble. So.
Okay. The voice vote too is kind of interesting. Well, we happen to mute. I do have questions about how a Zoom type meeting works when you have a potentially large public meeting our town meeting. I've only been in, you know, these are public meetings, but they're relatively small.
Yeah.
So I don't know the answer to that.
Yeah.
I would like to engage other staff to manage Zoom that evening, if that were a route to go. But
I feel comfortable. I personally would feel comfortable as long as it was being live streamed and that people were able to at least access watching it at the minimum, But
just two thoughts. One is we'd have to make it clear that the Zoom meeting would not allow any interaction.
Right. So maybe it wouldn't be Zoom. It might be YouTube, right?
Right. Like, I think maybe we should actually use a different
platform
because of that. The other one is, if we were to move ahead with a hybrid meeting, you couldn't do a voice, count. You'd have to do raise hands type thing.
Yeah, it'd be more for just, say the second half here when you conduct your floor business, and that if people want to engage with the public information hearing and have a question for town staff or the school, I could see that as, but we'll do whatever the board wants to do, but I'm just thinking of logistically that there might be, there's more technical items to work through to make that happen.
And certainly encourage people to pose questions ahead of time and things like that, you know, so that we could maybe, you know.
You're starting to hit on the area that I'm the least, the most uncomfortable with is not getting, you know, the comments, the questions coming in. One of the worry, as I start to think about this, I have is, you know, now that we're, I don't know if the right word is post-pandemic, but without there being the digital, the way to participate virtually, are we going to see a very small audience in our town meeting? Which to me, I'm disappointed in the numbers of folks that choose to show up, and this could make me very disappointed.
Mm-hmm. What's the, I mean, I don't recall, but what's the numbers like pre-pandemic were you kind of getting on town meeting?
120 or so.
Okay.
And that's just not representative of Williston.
Right.
When we went to Australian ballot, everything just fell apart as far as town meeting goes.
And if I remember correctly, we sort of knew it would.
I know we're hoping to have some, you know, we'll call it in the lobby engagement activities. I think the community center and library committee is thinking about maybe having something that evening for people to interact with some information gathering. We can also kind of share that as part of outreach to get people in the room to try to get some participation that way too.
Mm-hmm.
Just one thing on a typo on Article 12. There's an S on the end of member. That shouldn't be there.
Oh, thank you, Terry. And Article 5 reflects you know, the solar panel purchase. This is just a placeholder for now.
Yeah. Yeah.
Article 6, I previewed this last month, but this is the ambulance debt that was approved last year for short-term borrowing. We feel that we can get a 1% interest rate by selling bonds in this new municipal pool that they're starting to offer. So if the voters support this, it gives us both options and we can pick the best financing available.
I think for both Articles 5 and 6, I think it will be important to, you know, when I know you typically, you know, do something for the Observer or whatnot, but to you know, stress that one, that for Article 5 purposes, that this isn't a new bond, that this is not, we're not asking to take out more money, and then for Article 6 to remind folks that they've already approved the so
yeah.
There'll be an explanation sheet that we usually do, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Anything else on this particular one? If not, we're going to the manager's report.
So I'll lead off with the 2022 equalization study. Received it from the state. We're not surprised our CLA has dropped 7 points below the 85% threshold. So that is going to trigger an order from the state to conduct a reappraisal that will come this summer. Under state statute, we need to enter into a contract to conduct the reappraisal by the end of this year. So state statute says you need to have a contract, but it doesn't say when you need to complete it. As you've seen in Bill Hinman's memo, our assessor, we're really at unprecedented times here for reappraisal in the state of Vermont. Bill's found we've got 150 towns are receiving the same order as Williston this year, and next year he tells me the number is going to go up to 230 towns. There's 251 in the state. So essentially you're having the entire state reappraise in a series of about 5-6 years. The only towns that aren't going to be affected by this were the ones that did a reappraisal the last year or two. So there's about 3 or 4 firms who can do reappraisals. You're going to have towns that it's going to be 6-7 years before they can even have somebody in the door to do it. For Williston, we'll build back a meeting later this winter for you, but he's got a plan. We've got someone who conducted the reappraisal for us last time, who's willing to do it, it sounds like. And it looks like we have some options to just kind of do a desktop review like Burlington, South Burlington did. We may not necessarily need someone to physically go to each property and take out the tape measure and things of that nature. So we have a scenario where we can likely work on this in 24 and 25, and we won't be a number of years out. Bill speaks to other aspects here about our COD, and he's better versed in that than I am, so I can only paraphrase his memo here, but it's, looking to do a reappraisal, it's certainly not something towns look forward to, and it's something that we need to do, but probably looking to do it sooner rather than later is best to make sure that there's equity and valuation and moving forward. So that is a big project on the horizon here. Our reappraisal fund is certainly in good shape for the cost that we involved with this. That's funded as part of every recorded document and property transfers, I believe. So we've got a good amount of money in there to cover this, but it's certainly an interesting time here, and just with the magnitude of this for all the towns in the state.
Wow, 230?
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Next year.
Is that 251 number? It's 252 now, isn't it?
Oh yeah, Essex.
Yeah, not that fast.
That's right.
I mean, obviously.
No, that's a good
and
point.
A few unorganized wars.
We gotta reframe our
252.
252, yeah.
Kind of all those people who have those patches.
Yeah. Well, now they're a collector's item because.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. That's
251.
Remember
plus
best one Vermont was only 251.
Yeah. Any questions on that?
No.
If you'd like, I'll plan to have Bill Hinman back to kind of walk through some more detail this winter or spring for you.
So I'm a little bit curious about that concept. For instance, Williston would be required to have a contract by the end of 2023, calendar year. What if no company's willing to sign a contract with us?
I anticipate that
because
they
got too much work in front of us and they don't want to commit to a contract that they won't be able to work on for 2 or 3 years.
Yeah,
it could be a very open contract, and I anticipate the legislature will have an update on this as well coming up, as it's a topic that's going to affect everybody in the next couple of years. So that's a big one.
The one other point I guess I'll make, and I'll try to be real brief here. I don't think it's a bad thing, although it creates a lot of controversy. It's a bad thing to do one of those full reassessments every once in a while because things just get out of kilter. And
I can anticipate our grand list will go up by a good number, I would say. Yeah. Your value's going up, and conceivably your rate will likely go down, but then you're going to have essentially the same levy. You're just going to have higher values and a lower rate to raise the same amount of money in some circumstances.
I remember when the town did one reappraisal, our home value went up, the appraised value, and our taxes actually went down.
Yeah, that could happen too.
So just make sure that happens.
That'll be coming up. Some staff news to share. Assistant Public Works Director Lisa Schaefler is going to be leaving for a new opportunity.
My goodness.
Been here over 15 years, done a great job, secured a number of grants, managed a lot of projects. She's going to move into a public works director role in the town of Milton. So we certainly wish her well in her new professional opportunity here. She'll be wrapping up this Friday, before the holidays. So we'll be working on filling that position here. Also, we've hired two new firefighters. We had a vacancy last fall, and with Lieutenant Soper's retirement, they started today, and they're going to run through an eight-week academy. They both have experience, and I've met with them both, and great additions to our team here. So we'll be back in full strength on paper now and operationally in a couple months once they finish their training. Our ambulance billing RFQ, Shirley and Chief Collette led our staff review on that, and I've informed our preferred vendor candidates. We'd like to move forward with working on a contract with them, so they're going to send that to me this week, and hopefully we can get that squared away in short order so they can begin working on us for that very city. Stop the service in early December, so we've got to catch up on the December billing as soon as we can. So that's moving along. And I also wanted to mention we're working on the next quarterly report now. We spent a little extra time on the first quarter of the year. We're going to be working on the second quarter of the year. If you've got any feedback, because we kind of revamped it a little bit,
I like the new format. It's very good.
No, thank you. Yeah. And as we work on that, we can certainly add things, remove things as the board sees fit. It helps you get a sense quarterly kind of what our service delivery looks like and what's coming up. And also, just to close, I want to thank our fire, police, and public works staff for our situation we had on December 23rd with that wind that turned into a freeze event. It was certainly a very productive, busy day. We stood up our emergency operations center for a bit. We had public works coordinating out the fire station with police and fire. We had a number of vehicles. First thing in the morning, especially with the wind affecting going off the road a little bit, tree branches down, people without power for an amount of time. So, you know, we have great staff here, and especially when you have an emergency event like this, it's, for me, I'm always amazed by just the ease that they can work through it. And, you know, great, just kudos to our staff for working through that and protecting our community. That's all I have this evening.
Any other business for tonight? Sometime in the next week or two, you should be looking in your email in basket for a select board report that I'll be working on. So with relatively quick turnaround.
Okay. And I'll have a list of potential annual report dedication candidates to you, hopefully by early next week as well.
Okay.
I was going to say, Eric, to add to the current staff openings, our police department administrative assistant also gave her notice today.
Mm-hmm.
For next Friday.
Oh, ouch.
I've included my manager's report now, just a listing of open staff positions, if you're aware of kind of what that looks like on the personnel side.
Do we think that her leaving is specifically related to the adjustment of her role in terms of, do we know if that's?
I think I can say it's for a new opportunity, but I shouldn't go
into
kind of specifics.
Okay, that's fine, yep.
If there's no other business, we are adjourned.